Thank you everyone for joining us today for this Bequant webinar. I'm just going to do a quick introduction to Miro, what we are about. And then I'll hand over to Jose from Bequant, who will be doing the rest of the presentation. Okay, so obviously our Miro slogan is empowering you to connect communities. So now we just want to go into why do you want to partner with Miro? So Miro has 17 years of industry knowledge. We're a member of the Hudeco Group with a level 4 BEE status. We sell to over 35 countries. We have 5 branches, San Rand Centurion, Nelspruit, Durban, Cape Town, and Kenya. So we're quite widespread. Then we have a staff complement of over 170 staff members. Every 12 seconds, we ship at least one new product. In 2019, we shipped over 640,000 items, which is great. And then also, we have over 2,500 items in our sales catalog, with 95% of those shipped same day, which means that we are a stock-holding company. So we're not some other companies tend to only place their orders when they get orders. We actually hold stock of the items that we sell. So it's great to be partnered with Miro. And then you can follow Miro on Facebook, on LinkedIn, Instagram, Twitter, and YouTube. And there's all of the hashtags and everything that you need. And then, we're just going to go into why Miro. Okay. So first of all, we have tailor-made solutions. So rather than just box dropping, we actually sell end-to-end solutions, anything from pre-sales, planning, and to education. So we educate you via webinars like this. And Miro prides itself in being a value-add company. So like I said, we do end-to-end, full end-to-end solutions, and we supply the full end-to-end solutions of items that you would need. Then, like I said, we do the complete solutions, everything from Wi-Fi, broadband, mobile, fiber, networking, Internet of Things, you name it, we supply it. And on the support side, so we have a very strong technical support and customer service as well. We pride ourselves with our support that we do offer. And now we actually include on-site assistance. And if anyone would like some more information on that, you can just email support@miro.co.za for the offer on on-site assistance. And on the legal compliance side, this is obviously very important. We have to have our product certified and type approvals with NRCS and LOAs and all of those things. So we are legally compliant. Then we have our financing. So we offer anywhere from 7 to 30 day terms accounts for your month-to-month purchases, but we also offer our in-house IPFIN, which will basically just enable you to do much larger projects over a period of time.
Really long this thing, Miles.
Then we've got the training side. So lastly, we have the training, like these webinars that we're doing now with the product training on Bequant. Miro also hosts Zero to Hero training, which covers the basics of specific technologies such as wireless or fiber. There's many more. And then also we offer certified training on specific products. So just to name one, we have certified training on Microtik products. There's obviously more cambium and on all of those. And for any more information that you may need, you can just email training@miro.co.za for more information on that. And with that, I am going to unshare my screen and I will be handing over the reins to Jose from Bequant. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Maggie. Can you hear me all right?
100%.
Okay, so let me then share my screen and start the presentation. Just a second. Here we go. Can you see the presentation?
Yes.
Okay, very good. So Then I'll start. And thank you very much again, Maggie, and thanks all the people attending this webinar. We would like to introduce you to our product, which we are selling in South Africa and in other countries with Miron. And we have already been working with them successfully in the last few months. So our product does network optimization. And what does that mean exactly? Well, it means three things. We can accelerate your network, which means increase the actual speed that your users get out of your network. We do that with TCP optimization. We can analyze what is going through your network. We can tell you which services are the most, the ones that are used the most, and which subscribers are also the largest users. We do this with the packet inspection. And we can also limit the speed of certain applications for certain users at certain times, for instance, in cases of congestion. So I'll describe each one of these functionalities, and starting with acceleration. So when we say we accelerate, what we mean is that we increase the speed experienced by your network users. And that speed is not the same as the speed that your network provides to them. Because that's an example. If one subscriber from an ISP has a 10 megabit per second channel at that point where it can use these 10 megabits per second, but an application at a certain point sends only at 5 megabits per second, then 5 megabits per second is what this subscriber thinks it has. And this is something that happens often, that applications that people feel that applications are not using all the bandwidth that is available. What we can do is to help applications use a larger amount of this limit. For instance, if we have this 10 megabits per second and someone is using Netflix, let's say, instead of Netflix sending at 5, we can make Netflix send at 8 or something closer to the optimal speed, which would be very close to 10 megabits per second. So the thing, of course, then is to you would ask is, why would Netflix or any application send at a lower speed than is actually available? And the reason many times is in the transport protocols. Transport protocols like TCP, UDP, QUIC, others have been there from the beginning. They are very important in internet communications because they are the these TCP and these other protocols, they're the ones that, that decide at what speed they send data at each point. Mostly in the advanced, basically, this is something that happens mainly in the servers. Servers have to decide at what speed to send to each user. And it has to be different because different users have different bandwidths available. And each of these servers in a data center can handle, send maybe at up to 10 gigabits per second. But of course, they have to send at a specific speed, lower speed for each user. And they have to determine which is the optimal speed to send at each time. And, well, this is not an easy thing because in many cases, for instance, there may be many hops, and each hop up to the end user has a different bandwidth. And of course, we have to send at the lowest of these hop bandwidth, but not lower. Because if we send, for instance, in this case, if we send lower, that this example that we're following, if we send at lower than 10 megabits per second, then we are underutilizing the network. If we send, of course, at more than that speed, then we'll end up dropping packets because our building up latencies and dropping packets because there's no way that if you send at 12 and there's 10, at some point those you will lose packets. So then we have these transfer protocols that are in many cases limiting the speed of that your networks experience in your network. And what we can do is to help you when there is this transfer protocol is TCP. And TCP, the good thing is that TCP is the most used protocol in the internet, and it's about 80% of internet traffic. And how we can help you is with our product. A product, in the end, it's an appliance that you place in your network somewhere between your internet gateway and your access gateways, so that all the traffic goes through it. It has to be, it's a bump in the wire. And physically, it's just really off-the-shelf server, Intel-based server. And then our product really is a software that is installed on that server. And when we place it in your network and traffic goes through it, then we act as what is called transparent TCP proxy. And this is how we optimize TCP. And this is something that has been done for a very long time. It's been done for over 20 years, for instance, in all satellite networks. They use this technique. And not only satellite networks, but the most advanced wireless networks, like very large wireless carriers in the US or in many countries, like AT&T, Verizon, they use this technology. They have TCP proxies, transparent TCP proxies all around their networks to optimize the delivery of data with wireless networks. And how does it work? Well, let me show you what's the mechanism involved, so that you understand. And you see, there's no magic. Let's imagine there are two servers that want to send 7 packets. This is just an example. So TCP or any transfer protocol would send this in rounds, and probably first 1, then 2, then 4, trying to probe the capacity of that link, how fast it can go. And the clients, when they get here on the left, when they get any of these rounds of packets, they send an acknowledgement packet like that, saying, okay, I got that, sending more. So here on the top path we'll have no proxy, and the bottom we'll put in a proxy. It's a 5-second connection so that we can see the packets flowing, and we'll put it somewhere in between our 2 and 3, okay? And we'll count the packets to see why it is faster to have a proxy. And so the key is that when the first run gets to us, we will send an acknowledgement packet as if we were the end client, saying that packet has arrived safely. So when the server gets that acknowledgement packet, then it will send the second round, okay? And we will store it in a buffer we keep for every TCP connection. And now when the real acknowledgement comes from the end client, then we already have the second round, so we can send it out. And for instance, in this case, we have gained 4 seconds over the path that on top. And the same will happen with the third round. We'll gain 4 seconds for every round after the first one. So in this case, if we have transmitted these 7 packets in 17 seconds in the top, we'll take 8 seconds more, 25. Okay, so this is one of the ways, this is one of the three main mechanisms why we make your network faster. Because for this client here, the network and the contents are now coming from closer, because when it sends these acknowledgements, then the next round comes earlier. And in fact, it behaves, except for the first round, it behaves as if the contents were already in the ISP. And being closer in the ISP just means being faster in TCP and in all communications, really. If you send from closer, it is faster. So this is one of the mechanisms, and this is even more important if at any point you have any losses, packet losses in this between us and the end network, which can happen very often if there's any wireless here. And for instance, and wireless in fact happens, is there even in fiber networks, because the last link, the last hop usually at the home or in the company, it will usually be a Wi-Fi network. which is wireless and which will lose packets from time to time. So whenever you lose packets, it's not a problem for TCP in principle, because in these acknowledgement packets that we were mentioning before, apart from acknowledging those, they also can tell if they are missing any packets, and then they are get retransmitted. But now the good thing is that we are retransmitting them from much closer, because from this buffer that we are building. So this actually makes it much faster. And third, there's another third mechanism why we can accelerate your network. And this is because when we send out the packets from our appliance to your customers, we do it with our TCP, which is just like the regular TCP, except that we have improved the algorithm that decides at what speed to send. And so that when trying to reach the optimal speed, we will not get confused as TCP does. We will not be too conservative as TCP is usually. And we will end up, therefore, sending at the closer in general, at the closer speed to the optimal, which will result in a higher speed for your end users using the same network. Then how do we actually see it when we run our service in commercial service? Well, we have our product running in over 100 customers worldwide, mainly ISPs, also some hotels, some large companies with large networks, but mostly ISPs. And then out of ISPs, we have all kinds of ISPs. We have many wireless ISPs, but we also have ISPs that use fiber or cable, and we also have some cellular wireless LTE 4G cellular carriers like this one that we are showing here. Here we are showing the results for just 12 of these, and in this case, what we are showing is the average speed that we are seeing for TCP downloads with and without optimization. How do we do this? Because when we have our software running in these commercial networks, we always leave around 1% of all connections at random without any optimization. Just forward those connections, but measure them. So we have online measurements of the speed we're getting out of the downloads without optimization and of speed of downloads with optimization. So we can compare. And furthermore, here we have now for these data, we have selected just the Netflix service, so that it's more comparable. So we're here showing you the average speed of Netflix downloads with and without us and in these networks. For instance, if we take this fourth wireless ISP wireless ISP, we see that in gray, we have without us, it's 1.04 megabits per second average download speed for Netflix, okay? And 2.5 megabits per second with us, okay? So this means that the network is actually the same, but for some reason, Netflix was just sending at around one megabits per second, when it could have been sending at 2.5, because we were sending at 2.5 and it all went through, no problem. So why does Netflix? Well, it's Netflix uses a standard TCP and tends to be conservative, especially when there's wireless or when there are any packet losses or when there are long delays, long latencies, okay, large latencies. So this network is the same, just with our appliance, it feels faster for the end user because, for instance, in the case of video streaming, you will see probably better resolutions, fewer stalling events, and more satisfied customers, therefore. So this is about TCP optimization. Now let me go on to another functionality, which is about DPI, deep packet inspection, trying to show you what is flowing through your network. And for instance, here we're showing one of our customers. This is the kind of data that you will see in our application. This is 3 days of data. And here it's a fairly large network gets up to 15 gigabits per second at peak time. And we can here see these 3 days at each time, what is the breakdown, what services are using Zendo. For instance, this point was on 24th of September at 10 p.m. There were 15.2 gigabits per second flowing, and 11.6% was YouTube, 8.3% was Netflix and Facebook, Instagram, and all that. And you can see different times of the day what services are using your network the most, or you can see them all aggregated in just instead of hourly. And so this is one. This is information that you can use, for instance, to decide on which peering is more important and better for your network. Sometimes to see if there are problems with a specific applications. Then we can also show you, instead of viewing this from the point of view of services, view this from the point of view of users, IP addresses for us. So we can see, for instance, we can show you the 20 subscribers, that 20 IP addresses that push more traffic through your network. So in this case, for instance, there's these IP address at that time, for instance, that was on Christmas Day, last Christmas Day at 11 p.m. This was the IP address that was pushing the most. It was around 13 megabits per second, and out of a total of 100 megabits per second for these 20 main subscribers. And you can here see things like, well, this network probably has some limitation around 13 megabits per second, and some subscribers, when they use a network, they use it at full, at all it can handle. And you can also see here, for instance, you could also see you could use this to see if diagnose problems with certain subscribers, see they were getting a good speed or not at certain times, or even see which applications they were using at certain times in case they have problems with some of them. So this is the other, so this is so far information about usage, how your network is being used. And now, based on this ability to detect which applications, different traffic packet flows, what applications they belong to, we can now allow you to limit the speed of some of these applications. And we do this with bandwidth management. And so we allow you to configure, imagine, for instance, you can have several policies and you can apply a limit, for instance, if you wanted to limit the speed of video streaming per user to a limit, for instance, of 4 megabits per second. You can select here. You can select which applications this applies to with the domains that these applications use internally. You don't need to know this, because we have a number of signatures already in our, so you can select signature for video streaming. Then you select the applications that you want to limit, what speed you want to limit it per user, to which users you want to apply this limitation, because maybe you want to apply a different limitation for some users based on IP address or VLAN time. Maybe some users are in wireless networks, some users are in fiber networks. You apply different limitation. And furthermore, you would like to, maybe you probably want to apply this limit only when the whole network is getting closer to congestion. Probably, just imagine if you have a one gigabit throughput maximum in your network, and maybe only when it is above 800 megabits per second do you want to limit, apply any limitations at all? Because, when there's no congestion, maybe you don't need to apply any limitations. So this is, we allow all these factors to be used so that, why would you like to do this? Well, you would probably like to do this if you have any problems, because maybe your traffic has grown a lot and your internet connection is not big enough. So at this point, maybe you'll have to expand it, but it takes some time. Or maybe some areas in your network also would improve their quality if you limit them, because maybe your backhaul network is what is limited. So this is just a tool for you to do this. When we have done this, for instance, we have done that. What can you get out of this? Well, we have done this in one of our customers. We, for a period of 4 days, we limited video streaming to 4 megabits per second per user, per IP address. Okay, and we only video streaming, the rest was not limited. And what we did is to limit it during even hours, and then with a script, we just removed the limitation on odd hours. So from 10 to 11, it was limited, 11 to 12, it was not limited, and 12 to 1, it was limited, and so on. Okay, and so here in this graph, we can see these 4 days. So in red, we have the periods, the hours in which it was limited, what the average throughput of the network, and in gray, when it was not limited. So you can see that the peak traffic actually went down by around 15%. So this is about how much you can get out of this without, by the way, no complaints at all from this network regarding the quality of the video or the quality of the network. Because the thing is that when you do this with video streaming nowadays, most services or all services like YouTube, Netflix, all these, they measure the speed that they are getting from the network. And if that speed is lower, they just adapt themselves and send at a lower resolution. And that really uses much less traffic, much less volume of data. So by doing this, if you select this limit correctly, so that it does not become something that's limiting, for instance, with 4 megabits per second in any household would get 2 concurrent Netflix sessions without problems. If you have a fiber network, maybe you use a higher limit. We can help you with deciding what is the best limit. In the end, all this is so that you can get your network down the peaks by around 15-20%, something like that. And it's not probably something you want to do always. It's probably in certain situations, or maybe you want to do this always. It's just a tool. You have it there. Of course, it's not more than 15-20%, because we don't do magic. If you limit it much more, then you will get some complaints, because you know, in the end, there's nothing's free, okay? But you're doing this mostly because there is a limitation. So this, in fact, if you do this when there is some congestion in the network, the actual result will be better quality for all your users. Because the thing is that we also measure, for instance, the here on the right, we have the measurements for latency, and we saw that the latency, average latency, was reduced when there was limitation. And this is because video streaming basically takes all the bandwidth there is. And so when doing so, it'll tend to fill up all the buffers. So when you limit it, that doesn't occur and the latency goes down. So in general, so out of this, you get, you know, maybe people that were going to get much higher resolution are not getting it, but in congestion, they are getting a decent resolution, and all the other users that would not get very good resolution at all in congestion, now they are getting a minimum resolution, which is okay. So overall, you're getting a better quality out of your network. So what is the advantage of this kind of quality of service that we are offering over other possibilities that you have from other vendors? One of them is that we can get this with the TCP traffic. We can do this without dropping any packets, which is much better quality. And we do, and this is because in those acknowledgement packets we were showing in the animation a few slides back, those can also tell the server about the window to use. And basically we can set the speed limitation back from the server. So we can, otherwise, like we have to do, for instance, for UDP services, basically then you have a buffer, you limit to a maximum, and if the server sends at a higher speed, that you'll end up dropping packets, which is bad for quality. But with this, we'll be setting the speed right in the server. So everything will be fine and much better quality. And also we are doing this at the same time we do acceleration, which means that we are still helping, for instance, in this example, for maybe some connections were at 1 Mbps, we can get them up to 2. But however, anyone going at 3.5, we would not get it up to 5 Mbps. And now it's limited to 4. So actually the worst connections are being helped. The ones that would do better are not, but those are already good. So we are sharing the limited resources of the network in a more fair way. And so overall, the quality will be better in your network. And we also think that our pricing is competitive and configuration is easy. So now, after covering what we do, how we do this, we run our software. There in South Africa, we are selling the license to our software. We require that you get a server. We can advise you what server is required. It can probably be a server that you already own, or it can be a new one. We can help you decide what server is required, depending on how the throughput that you need to push through it. We, for instance, many times use Europe and the US versus these servers from Supermicro. They are they can get up to 10 Gbps. They cost around $1,500. If you want, there's the possibility to go up to 50 Gbps in 1U also, with a server costing around $4,000 US dollars. And we can also, of course, work with any other brands, like Dell, HP. We can help you decide on the hardware. Once hardware is solved, then we help you. We send you the software. It is installed like a Linux distribution. It's fairly easy. We'll also support you doing so. And once you have the server already installed, we have to deploy it. To deploy it, it's easy also, because we work at level 2. We are like a bridge, basically with 2 ports, and then so everything that comes in one gets out the other. So no IP addressing required. In fact, it can be several of these links that can go through us, so you can have an aggregate link going through us transparently. You do need an extra port, of course, for management. For this one, we do need an IP address. This is just to see the results, configure. So minimum 2 ports, one for each side, towards the internet, one towards your subscribers, and then a 3rd port for the management. Okay, if they are Intel ports, they will work faster, but up to 1 gig, it's not so important. And then finally, we can help you also set up a bypass link using active backup, for instance, bonding from MikroTik or LACP from Cisco. We can also help you with that. And that way, if there's any problem with the server, the traffic will go through this bypass link. Since we are a transparent proxy, things can happen, and this can be done without affecting the service or your subscribers getting any problems. As I said, we have over 100 deployments worldwide. Already 4 or 5 in commercial service in South Africa, in the US, in Americas, in Europe, also in Italy, Spain, and France. And we are starting also in Asia. Some of our references over here, in what our customers are saying, for instance, in Interworks from South Africa, they they were very happy because the amount of support calls complaining about low speed test buffering when streaming went dropped tremendously. So that resulted in a much happier customer base. Also, this is another network from the US, basically, again, getting happier customers because of video streaming went smoother and no more complaints. Planes internet also. Several with fast.com, they saw improvements up to 100%. Depends on every network. So basically what we are saying is you should try it. We allow you to have a trial license, a free trial license, so that there's no risk for you. We help you set it up, test it, help you trial it and see the results. If you see that you get the results we tell you we can get, then you can keep it. And then there's, of course, if you decide to keep it, there's the pricing, and these are the pricing that you will get from Miro. These is in rands, and it's basically either a monthly subscription or a perpetual license. So depending on the throughput, if you have like 500 megabits per second, would start with 2,936 rand for a monthly subscription, which includes support, or a perpetual license for that amount would be 49,698 rands. Then, of course, the prices per gigabit drop quite a lot as you go up, and these are the prices per node. Okay, so. So I think this is it regarding the product. We really encourage you to try it for free. We have many satisfied customers. I think in South Africa also, because of the latencies that you sometimes have with certain services, we are seeing even better results than what we are getting in other countries. But best thing, try it, and we hope that you will not regret it. So maybe now, if there were any questions made during the presentation, Maggie, I don't know if you, maybe we can try to answer them.
Yeah, there's nothing in the chat box at the moment. So if anyone's got any questions, please do ask them in the chat box. Can I just ask, so what is the difference with the cache?
Okay, well, yeah, it's true that we sometimes are compared with a cache server, and it's not the same thing in the sense that, you know, cache from Netflix or from whatever other service just usually works for that specific service, or they used to work for all when we had there was no encryption and there was HTTP. Now, almost everything is encrypted, so they only work for certain services. And also the other difference is that we do not, if someone is downloading something from Netflix and another one is downloading the same thing, we don't know what they are downloading. So we are keeping this buffer without knowing what's in it, so we're not reusing this from one to the other.
Okay, fantastic. And then we've got a question in the chat box from Shaul, who's asked, how long does the trial or the demo version last for?
Yeah, we are in principle allow 15-day trials. We think that is enough time. We can be a little flexible, but this is, we see that with all customers that is more than enough to see the improvements when you install this.
Okay, and if there's anyone else who wants to raise a question. I have another one. These are actually also some questions that were asked in previous webinars that we've done with Bequant. So if I use the MikroTik in my network, is it compatible with Bequant? And do I have to do any changes in my network to deploy the product?
Not really. I mean, it is compatible, and you don't need to do any changes in the set, but you just need to find, and we can help you find which is the right spot to install this, to deploy this, so where it is better to deploy this so that it is more efficient and you don't need as many appliances, you need as few appliances as possible. It's more economical. And whenever there is a link from one node to another node, like for instance from a router to a switch, now we break that link and just make it go through us. So it's really not. You don't need to do changes. We may need to do this, and we'll help you if you want to have a bypass link. Then we can help you do that. It's called an active backup bonding in the case of MikroTik, and we can help you do it so that all the traffic is going through a link through us. In normal conditions, if we are turned off or whatever, then all the link in a few tenths of a second will be flowing through that backup link in parallel.
Okay, fantastic. And then I just also wanted to ask, Does it also optimize encrypted traffic?
Yes. Encrypted traffic, encrypted SSL TLS traffic is encrypted above. We don't need to see what is inside. We optimize it. We can also, even in encrypted traffic, find if all encrypted traffic is completely encrypted, you're going to see it, except in the first part. There's a, you should, almost always, the clients send a domain name, say, for instance, Netflix, they send certain domain names, Google and other others, or YouTube. And so the out of those is how we get to which service the whole flow, which from then on will be optimized to which it belongs. And so, but yes, we can optimize encrypted traffic just as unencrypted traffic.
Okay, perfect. Just one more question from my side, and I will post to everyone on this webinar. I will get Q&As from previous webinars as well, and then we'll send them to you. I just wanted to ask, does it work in a virtual server? And then on top of that, I wanted to ask, can I use my own server to do the trial as well?
Okay. Yes. So regarding that, can you use your own server? Yes. You can use some server that you may have had, you may have from before, if it is powerful enough. We don't need a lot of power, really. Our software is really efficient. For 1 gig, even an i5, even a laptop could run it. You, of course, you don't want to run it on a laptop, but this means that we can be quite efficient and you require very little hardware. Now, regarding the virtual servers, it does not, it is not available right now, but it will be very soon available. We hope in our next release, it will be. It's a license issue that we are fixing with virtual servers. But at this point, you need a physical server.
Okay, perfect. And if no one else has any more questions, I will post all of the Q&As from previous webinars and it'll be sent to everyone via email. Let's just give it another minute if anyone's got any questions, or just answer no in the chat box if you guys understood everything and you don't have questions.
In any case, whatever questions may arise later, of course, if they send them to you or to us, we'll be more than happy to answer them.
Perfect. Thank you so much. I do appreciate that. Let's just see. Okay, everyone seems to be very happy with the webinar, and everyone understood it. So thank you very much, Jose. Really appreciate you coming on today to do this webinar with us.